2009 was a big year for the NASCAR Camping World Truck Series as the 15th season in the sport, cementing its place for the future of NASCAR as not only a developing ground for some drivers, but also was established as a proving ground for some veterans of NASCAR racing. And for some, like Kyle Busch, it was a place for fun. We even had motocross legend Ricky Carmichael racing in NASCAR at that time. Speed Channel's broadcasting team featured Rick Allen, Phil Parsons, Adam Alexander, Ray Dunlap, and many others to help provide the voice of the truck series at that time. For anything to be around for 15 years, that proves just how big something is, and 2009 was certainly a season to never forget in NASCAR Camping World Truck Series history. Today, though, I want to talk about what transpired on September 12, 2009 at Gateway International Raceway, a standalone track for the truck series at that time, as NASCAR's Cup Series was in Darlington, South Carolina, and until 2022, the NASCAR Cup Series had not raced there. This was the second running of the Copart 200 for the 2009 season. Don't let this one get confused for the earlier Copart 200 ran at the Milwaukee Mile, which was won by Ron Hornaday in an event that would set off an impressive 5-race run of victories for Hornaday. A couple things to note about this race. Colin Braun was the pole sitter for this race, driving Jack Roush's Conway Freight Ford, and the 51 truck, which was ran by Kyle Busch for a good portion of the 2009 season, was being piloted today by Eric Almirola. Mike Skinner won the previous race, the Lucas Oil 200, the previous week at Iowa Speedway, after Kyle Busch won 2 in a row after Hornaday's run of 5 consecutive victories. The championship favorites for the 2009 season were Ron Hornaday, Todd Bodine, Mike Skinner, and Matt Crafton, who until this race was still winless in 2009. Keyword is still. But while Crafton has proved he doesn't need many wins or even any in the case of the 2019 season to be a champion after this moment, this race here will forever be etched in my memory as Matt Crafton's most controversial race ever. Now Gateway, as we all know watching it today, is a very interesting track. It's a 1.25 mile speedway, and you can definitely get speedway speeds out of a track like this, but it really does race like a short track, with narrow straightaways and flat, sharper turns, with an interesting wall opening on the backstretch that had been known for producing some insane crashes and moments in years past, particularly in 2004. This 160-lap race started off fairly normal. Colin Braun went to the lead on lap 1, but it did not take long for points leader, most dominant full-time racer Ron Hornaday, to go to the lead, where he would lead for a good part of the start of the race. We would see a couple of cautions to start the race, but nothing too serious. By the time we reached lap 47, though, things were getting feisty in the front of the field as Colin Braun and Ron Hornaday were making contact, which opened the door for Todd Bodine to go to the lead, while Matt Crafton had made up some ground and was quickly in contention now. However, even with as exciting as it got there, it would not take long for Hornaday to get back out front where he'd stay for a good portion of the race. A little past the midway portion of the race, around lap 82 on a restart, we saw the first chaotic moment of the race in a chain reaction wreck that collected at least 4 trucks, including Brian Eichler, TJ Bell, and James Buescher. Things go smoothly for a bit until lap 103 when Terry Cook and Ricky Carmichael got together, causing a lot of damage to the trucks of Cook and Carmichael, but just before that, we saw things brewing with Matt Crafton and Ron Hornaday when he got into the back of the 33 truck of Hornaday, pushing him up the racetrack, allowing others a chance to get by. When we came to the restart on lap 107, things kept brewing between the two even more, with Matt Crafton all over the back bumper of Hornaday once again, pushing the 33 up the racetrack, but Hornaday scooted ahead in the battle for 4th spot. While Hornaday got away clean in this case, the next guy to battle Crafton did not come out so clean as Colin Braun was on the inside of Crafton, and the two made contact going into the turn. Now it's hard to tell if Braun came up or if Crafton came down, but I lean more towards Colin wiggling going into the turn, but regardless, after close run-ins to the 33 truck, the 88 of Crafton had just helped contribute to an accident for the first time of the day, but Colin Braun would later admit fault in this incident here, saying he just got too close to the 88. On a restart at lap 112, everyone's oh-so-favorite Truck Series racer, Rick Crawford, I say that very sarcastically, led us back to the green flag following the incident with Braun and Crafton. Rick Crawford battles here with Brian Scott briefly before Todd Bodine and Ron Hornaday get their way in there to mix it up for the lead of 48 laps to go, with multiple guys getting loose and nearly wrecking during this exchange. It ultimately settled out with Hornaday back to the lead, Bodine in second, and Crafton came out third of 45 laps to go. But just when it looked as though Ron Hornaday could be cruising away to his 7th victory of the 2009 season, in an attempt to also sweep the two Copart 200s in 2009, a caution came out with 11 laps to go due to debris, which meant this one wasn't over and anything can and would happen. With 10 laps to go, Adam Alexander asked Ron Hornaday's crew chief, Rick Wren, if he had some times handy, to which he responded with, "I already ate a quarter bottle today. I'm just waiting for something to go wrong." Little did he know at that time, but he was predicting the future. With 8 laps to go, Ron Hornaday led the field to the green flag, getting a great restart and plenty of room ahead of Todd Bodine, when Matt Crafton swung wide going into the first turn, getting underneath Bodine for second, while Bodine was blocking, attempting to defend his position, when suddenly, Todd Bodine spun going into turn 1, sliding up and collecting Rick Crawford and Colin Braun. Now whether you place the blame on Crafton for making the move or Bodine for blocking Crafton, it still didn't look good that after the aggressive moves by Crafton earlier in the day already, he had now been involved in an incident that took out Bodine, a front runner, and Colin Braun, who was already nursing his truck after an earlier incident with Matt Crafton. Each side has their take on it, but ultimately the race was red flagged with 7 to go to clean the racetrack, and Todd Bodine had some very choice words for Matt Crafton.
"It's hard to get going when you have Chevrolets on each end of you and you're lacking 20 horsepower from what they got. That's right where it shows up on restarts. And I tried to jump it a little bit, held back from Ron and jumped it, but Matt got a good restart. You know, I blocked him, no doubt about it. But how stupid do you have to be to turn somebody going in the corner with 8 laps to go? I mean, there's no cure for stupid. This kid has done this crap his whole career. He's done it to Hornaday this year. He just did it to me. Hell, he wasn't even up far enough to turn me. And I can tell you, man, what goes around comes around. That kid's going to get turned. I'm telling you straight out."
Bodine was definitely mad, and a lot of it was probably due to pent-up frustration towards Crafton, but to me, as bad as it looked, I would say the fault was not on Crafton in this particular case, but in his words, "I ain't scared." So he continued on, ready for what the rest of the race had. So now let's set the stage. Todd Bodine is out, and Matt Crafton is now second behind the 33 truck of Ron Hornaday. Hornaday had been great on the previous restarts, but so has Crafton. And he had already proven he can get on the back of the 33 already in this race. And as Crafton had already said, he wasn't scared. The race would restart with 4 laps to go. Hornaday leads them to the green flag, with Crafton getting a good restart on the 33, and almost the exact same way as before, the 88 swings left inside the 33, but this time, it seems more like fault was on the 88, as he didn't seem to leave the 33 any room. Yes, the 33 truck did block 2, but this one definitely did not help the 88 after having been involved in his second crash of the day. It may not have been intentional, but in this case the 88 was not there alongside the 33 this time like he was with the 30, and in this case it just looked like the 88 braked too late going into the turn, and ultimately Hornaday, the points leader and truck that dominated the race, had wrecked. Hornaday went for a spin in turn 1, much like Bodine's crash, only instead of going through the grass, he bounced off the wall and came into oncoming traffic, completely destroying the Longhorn Smokeless Tobacco Chevy Silverado. The 88 team remained calm during all of this, but then again, they still had a truck that wasn't wrecked. It's debatable if any of these situations were intentional or if Crafton was at fault, but Bodine, he certainly saw the 88 at fault, and the crew of the 33 also saw the 88 of Crafton to be at fault here. Under the red flag once again, NASCAR worked to clean up the track while the 33 team packed up for the day, but not before stopping by the 88 team's pit stall to give them some looks of shame and say that they are number one, but of course you can imagine what finger they held up to say that. Most people would probably say that this was just a racing deal, but at that time, Hornaday was a crowd favorite, and probably arguably a favorite of the sport. And Crafton did receive a lot of boos that day, and NASCAR also did not see it to be just a racing deal. The 88 truck of Matt Crafton was then posted for rough driving on the ensuing restart, so rather than being the leader of the race as he was following the crashes of Todd Bodine and Ron Hornaday, Matt Crafton was black flagged and put to the back of the lead lap trucks, placing him in 13th on the restart. The crowd definitely cheered for this move, and the crowd there at Gateway did not appreciate the racing that they had seen from Matt Crafton that day. Maybe it was accidentally done, But Crafton, in a controversial fashion, was not going to be contending to win this race after being probably the third best truck all day in that race. Now all of a sudden, the two lead trucks were trucks that had not contended all day long, with the 5 truck of Mike Skinner being in the lead, which was also last week's winner, and the 13 truck of Johnny Sauter, Matt Crafton's teammate, was sitting behind him in second, and the 16 truck of Brian Scott, who had been kind of a really good underdog that season, was now in third place. Meanwhile, Matt Crafton, who claimed he wasn't scared, well, he should have been scared because he had 2 laps to try and get from the back to the front. Spoiler alert, that's impossible. Mike Skinner led them to the green flag, and the 13 truck very nearly did what his teammate had done for 2 consecutive restarts, but he checked up and fought better of it, staying on the bumper of the 5 truck, as the 5 took the white flag, and all the way to the finish of the race, Mike Skinner did what he needed to do, holding off the 13 truck to win 2 races in a row. Brian Scott would come home third, and the rest of the top 5 would be decided in a 3-wide finish, with Eric Almirola finishing 4th, Taylor Mawson finishing 5th, and after all that drama, Matt Crafton would finish 6th. Crafton arguably did really good to rally into the top 10, and he was even close to a top 5, but in all reality, perhaps one could argue that it should have been the 88 truck of Matt Crafton who went to victory lane that day, rather than Mike Skinner. Regardless of if he was at fault or not, circumstances and NASCAR's view of the situation perhaps robbed Matt Crafton of a win in what went on to be a winless season for the 88 team, in what could have easily been argued as Matt Crafton's most controversial NASCAR race ever. The 5 team owned by Randy Moss at that time would celebrate, and Ron Hornaday and Todd Bodine were seen chatting, perhaps about their run-ins with Matt Crafton that day. But when Hornaday was then asked to comment on the situation, he simply acknowledged it as a little bit of stupidity on the racetrack that day. Perhaps he and Bodine just saw that justice had been served by NASCAR at that moment, or perhaps the comfort level was just there and set in for Hornaday at that point. I mentioned earlier that Matt Crafton would not win in 2009, but neither did Hornaday for the rest of the year, as this was his last really good shot to win without a Cup driver being in his way. Kyle Busch, Johnny Sauter, Timothy Peters, and Kevin Harvick would win out the rest of the season that year. After Gateway, Hornaday held a 192-point lead over Matt Crafton in second, 213 over Skinner in third, and 418 over Brian Scott in fourth. Aside from Brian Scott spiraling from 4th to 7th, things would not change too much, with Ron Hornaday winning the season championship by 187 points over Matt Crafton. Crafton was never going to be able to chase down the 33 for the title, but you know, on that day in 2009, it really had to sting the 88 team to lose in such controversial fashion. Now let me know what you thought down below. Was Crafton at fault in either situation, or was this just a racing deal seen poorly by NASCAR that day? Be sure to leave your thoughts down in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, then be sure to leave a like and make sure to subscribe to the channel and click the notification bell to never miss future uploads from Danny B Talks. And as for my Danny B super fans, well, as always, thanks so much for your monthly support to the channel. It truly does mean a lot to me, and for that, I want to say thank you. Also, just as a reminder, we are continuing to raise money for December tornado relief for the Red Cross. If you'd be so inclined to donate just $3, we could reach our goal of $50,000 by February 28, 2022. That's less than a snack and a drink from a gas station. We still have a long ways to go, having raised only $210, so please, I encourage you to donate just $3. 100% of the donations go directly to the Red Cross for disaster relief. None of it goes to me or YouTube, and YouTube covers 100% of all processing fees out of their pocket to make sure none of the donation revenue is ever taken away. As always, I appreciate you taking time to check out my channel today, and I hope you have a great day until I see you next. Take care, and have a great day. Bye, guys.
Hey, race fans. Thanks for watching this video from Danny B Talks. If you're new to my channel, please be sure to hit subscribe and click the notification bell so you never miss another video from my channel.